Howdy folks, time for a little update on this 1931 Frigidaire. It has been under vacuum all night after putting the condensing unit back in. And everything was pressure checked, as you remember. So as expected, it still has full vacuum, as well as you can tell with those type of gauges. And everything is ready to go with some refrigerant. Now sadly, this cold control, somehow I broke it. One of the cables is broken up in here. I'm gonna have to take this entire side off the cabinet again. I'm really upset about that, but it is what it is. So that's why this isn't hooked up. I don't see any bending here where it looks like it got pulled back onto the unit while I was sliding it in. I really don't know what happened. But either way, I'd rather it happen here than later when this is somewhere else. You know, I did go back with all the original hardware. After washing those, they're still good. So we have the suspension thing going on. And in the back, got the new dryer put in place up there. There. All the lines are connected to the unit, sight glass, everything. It's cored in place, tied down. So it'll just be a matter now of getting some refrigerant in there and seeing if she cools. So basically the load put on the compressor depends on how much material it's having to pump and compress from the low side around to the high side, is scaled by the pressure difference. So you know, the amount of material coming in on the low side kind of multiplies with the amount of pressure working against it on the high side. So if you have a high amount of flow going through the loop and a high pressure on the condenser, it really puts a load on the compressor. And it sees load from the evaporator, return gas from the evaporator, and from the can when you're charging it. So you're giving it essentially a double load while it's circulating and trying to charge. So once I get some pressure in the system, I'm going to close off the outlet from the receiver going up to the evaporator. That way the only refrigerant vapor the compressor will get is going to come from the cans of refrigerant, and that's going to help keep from overheating the condensing unit while it's charging. And once I get enough refrigerant in there where I'm pretty sure that the float valve is going to be satisfied and close off, then I'll let it circulate and charge and circulate it at the same time. But for the initial startup, all valves are open where it's going to circulate gas as soon as pressure builds up and activates the control. So right now, you know, it's cycle off. If that goes down is when it runs, but it's cycle off. And I can't turn it off manually without the control chain. I explained earlier it's not going to be working right now. But it's kind of in an intermediate position where as soon as gas pressure goes in the system, it should start up. So right now, all the gauge valves are shut, and I'm going to connect a can of refrigerant. This was a partial can left over from another project, so it's probably going to be enough to activate the control, but not enough to get any liquid in the system. So I got the low side still in a vacuum. I'm going to start letting in refrigerant. Watch the control. Can may not have been quite enough. Oh, there she goes. cycled off already. Because we have barely got any charge in the system. I'm going to try to block this where it's in a colder position. That may not work. Okay, I'm going to have to make an alternate plan to hold that in the run mode without the control chain on it, and I'll come right back when I've got it ready to go again. Okay, I finally got that straw in there. Not sure what that little squeaking noise is it's making. I think it's got to do with the suspension more than anything. Open the door here. You hear the gas blowing through the evaporator because there's no liquid circulating yet. So I got a pan of warm water to help boil off the refrigerant. I think the belt might be slipping a little bit. Might be what that noise is. So what I'm interested in is the sight glass. There's a little window in that brass fitting right there. That's where we'll see something start going by when there's some liquid in the receiver. But what I'm going to do, like I said, to try and minimize the load on the compressor, I'm going to close off this valve here. It's something I can get a grip on. I cut it off for a minute because I didn't want to draw into a vacuum. Start up again. So now the only gas going to the compressor is coming from the can. I think that first can is empty. You can see I've almost got zero on the gauge right there. I don't want to try to change a can like that because there could be a little bit of vacuum and that might make it draw air in the system. So I'm going to open this up just a touch. Now I've got about 10 PSI on there, so I can take this can tap off, and I know I'm not going to draw air back in the hose. All right, we'll start it back up. Put more belt tension. See, that stops the chirping. One thing about this, I don't know why the suspension is so much different with these little loops of fabric or cord. The ones that have just the eye bolts, you don't see that much rocking. I don't like that because I think it's going to be hard on the lines over time. Try to stuff something in there to calm it down. This is slightly warm. Got about 100 pounds on the high side. This machine had a busted belt tensioner spring when I got it. And the spring that I purchased for it might be a little bit weaker than the original. Might be why that belt's doing that. Alright, she cycled off. I let the pressure get a little bit low, but that's okay. That's let's say a can and a half, because that first can had a half in it. Go ahead and switch up to the next can. Once I get three full cans plus that half in the system, I'll open up the receiver valve that I closed and let it start circulating through the evaporator. Then let it stabilize and see if it's how much more it's going to need. The pan of water I'm using to help this stuff evaporate out of the can is like ice water now. I can't even put my hands in it. I may have to go change it out for some. It's warmer. It started out as hot water out of the hot water tap. It's a fairly quiet machine now that it's kind of stabilized a little bit. It's very hot today, so some of the background noise is the shop fan running behind me. Well, I guess that can's almost empty if it shut down by itself. Go ahead and turn the power off and go change out my now extremely ice cold water bucket for some warm water. So you can see the ice buildup. Seems like the control is at least functional. I don't know about calibration, but it starts and stops based on pressure like it's supposed to. So this will be the third full can once this one goes in. And once that happens, I will open up this receiver outlet valve and let the refrigerant go to the evaporator. Maybe we'll get frost on the evaporator, hopefully. gauge readings are running about 125 on the high side. And then the low side, again, that's just can pressure going in with that valve shut, so we really don't care much about that. Basically what that means is it's taking 125 pounds of pressure to compress that R152A back down and allow it to condense to a liquid in this hot room. And it goes in here, and this is just a little bit warm. It's got a heck of a fan, you know, on the motor to cool that condenser. Plus the flywheel fan on the compressor. I was talking about those cord type suspension springs. You know, you see the spring just on the edge of the screen with the rod going down. The other ones that these I've worked on have had a longer steel J-hook, so to speak, and haven't had those little cords down there. And I think maybe that Frigidaire changed that, took the cord out to stop that wobbling, because I've not seen any of the other ones wobble quite like this. And I know that's going to cause metal fatigue on the lines if it stays like that. They put a lot of loops up there to help give those lines flexibility, but still, you know, it's quiet enough with the metal J-hooks. Can is empty, yep. I changed my mind. I'm going to go ahead and put a fourth can in there before I open that valve. Because that first one, the partial can, I think that one might not have had as much in it as I was really thinking. I changed the brushes in that motor, and I think that's why it's got such a pronounced brush noise when it starts. It's typically the Delco motors are a lot quieter, but once it has a few run hours on it, I bet you that noise will get quieter. Still running right at 125 on the high side. You notice more and more material is going in, but the pressure's not going up, and that's because all that stuff is forming, changing to a liquid, and it's just collecting in the receiver down here, which I don't know. Yeah, I think it's just off screen, but the receiver's a little tank right down here, because none of that is recirculating and boiling off in the evaporator and adding heat to the system. That's why the high side pressure is just staying low. Once it's circulating and actually doing refrigeration work from the cabinet, there'll be a lot more heat load on it. And I bet the high side is much higher than that. The last couple of videos you guys have seen of me charging these belt drive Frigidaires, I probably left all the valves open and let it circulate while it was charging. But I think during that time of year it wasn't real hot, so I wasn't concerned about the overloading. But being that it's, you know, more than 90 degrees in here, it's stressful on the system. Just trying to give it the best chance I can, you know. The camera stopped recording by itself. I don't know if that was from me not touching the buttons on it or what, but I don't think I lost that much. The last can is in the process of going in, but it got so much ice on the can that insulated it and made the unit cycle off before all the gas was out of the can. So I'm gonna crunch off some of that ice and put it back in the water pan. And maybe it'll kick back in one more time. Yeah, there it goes. Draw the rest out of this one. Chunk of ice off the refrigerant can.
almost empty.
So now, I'm going to connect another can, but I'm not going to let it go in there. I'm going to open the receiver valve, but I want to have this can ready and standby so that when it needs it, I can open the valve, the gauge valve, and let it in. So right now, this valve is blocking the liquid refrigerant from going up to the evaporator. So when I open that, it'll be able to come through this line and go into the evaporator header and complete the refrigeration cycle, and the unit should start up. You'll see it go by the sight glass. I don't have enough grip on it. You hear it up there now. Trying to do this one-handed. See the sight glass flowing? So my hands are wet and I can't do it. I'm going to have to put the camera down and finish opening that valve. You hear it flowing through there. You can hear now it's got a heavy load on the compressor. $150 on the high side and $50 on the low side. Hope the motor doesn't stall. She's working as hard as she can. Has to cool that entire heavy evaporator down. I don't know if you can see it, but now there's bubbles going by on the sight glass. Okay, that's fully open. I'm going to give it a chance to cool down the evaporator some and not be so work so hard before I start giving it more vapor from the can to try and make up for that and fill in that the bubbles. The low side was running 50 psi right at first, now we're down to about 35. I'm going to start giving it a little more vapor from the can. As you can see, right in there, there's bubbles going by on the sight glass, so that tells me it's not fully charged yet. Hear the boiling. There was also a blast of cool when I opened the door that fell out of there. That's probably the first time this cabinet has had cooling of its own power in decades. Well, we know since 1983 at least. So, you know, the work done by this system is done by the boiling off of that refrigerant in the evaporator. When it changes from a liquid state back to a gas, that's what actually cools the refrigerator cabinet. And then the work being done by the compressor is determined by how much gas it has to compress to circulate. So when you see the bubbles going by on the sight glass, that is gas that is going back to the evaporator. It never did change to a liquid. So that gas circulates and it goes back to the compressor, and it does not cool the cabinet at all because it was never a liquid. So it can't change state from a liquid to a gas and absorb heat. But it does go back to the compressor as a gas and load the compressor. So that is wasted power you see going by. That's work being done by the compressor that's not benefiting anything. So when it's undercharged like that, it's going to really increase the power demand and reduce the cooling performance. So when that sight glass looks like water, you know, clear, then we'll know that it's fully charged. The bubbling is a lot less active right now, so I think we're getting closer. I think it's not going to be long, it's going to be clear. So you see now it's more liquid than bubbles, so we're getting there. You know, back when this was sold, Frigidaire knew that the days were very numbered for the belt drive units. GE already had the DR monitor top design out, and Frigidaire already was well in the development of their Metermizer sealed compressor system with the capillary tube. So to market these, they were trying to market them based on the few positive traits. One of them was the cooling power. There's an advertising pamphlet that I've seen. It said Frigidaire super powered refrigerator, twice the cooling power of the competition. And it showed the big finned evaporator with the cooling fins on it. And they were saying, you know, this one will cool down the cabinet a lot quicker and don't have as much cool down time if you open the door. This is interesting, you know, they knew the strengths and weaknesses of all the systems, both the upcoming sealed units and this, and trying to keep marketing these to the very end, they had that super powered refrigerator thing that they said. Oh, if you notice, the window is clear now. So this can is almost empty. I personally, nobody has a lot of experience with these because there aren't many of them left. But personally, I like to put in one full can of refrigerant, 10 ounce can, after that's clear. That way you know that there's a good cushion of extra in the receiver to make up for contingencies, minor seepage or changes in ambient temperature, anything that affects the dynamics of the system, it's going to be still running like it should. I definitely think the belt tensioner spring needs to be stronger. Probably not by much, but by a little bit. So you see now that the sight glass is clear, 100% of the material that flows up through that sight glass is capable of doing useful work in cooling the cabinet. There's no dead wood going up, so to speak. It's all liquid that can boil in the evaporator and do work. So the compressor is not spending any power circulating gas that doesn't ever perform useful work. And that really applies to all refrigeration systems that use vapor compression. Certain designs, like, you know, capillary tube systems, it's very tricky to get them where there's not some uncondensed vapor going through, but in general, if they're working properly, there shouldn't be vapor going through the cap tube. You get into some of the really highly specialized systems like the automotive AC with orifice valves, then everything changes. But, you know, when I'm talking about refrigeration in the context of these size and type of things, you know, like domestic refrigerators and Coke machines and those kind of things. So I'm fixing to change to another can of Freon. And this will be the final can that goes in, and I'll consider that fully charged. So running about 150 on the high side and 20 on the low side. And of that 20, some is can vapor coming from the can, so it was lower before I put that last can on there. You know, Frigidaire used the same compressor pump and motor design on a bunch of these W series refrigerators, the porcelain or the white, you know, porcelain ones on legs. Regardless of size, they used it on some two-door cabinets and small cabinets as well. And the difference was the size of the evaporator and the size of the receiver mainly. It seems like, you know, if they would have one that would hold four sets of ice trays in the evaporator and had a lot more liquid volume there, they'd give it a bigger receiver so the entire charge could fit in the receiver for pumping down. And then on the small ones like this, it's got a little shorty receiver in there. I worked on the W8 last year, big two-door cabinet, and it had the same motor and compressor, but the compressor skid was wider, the frame of the condensing unit, and it had a much larger receiver on it. That thing was heavy too, I'll tell you what. I assisted the owner of the W8 to set it up in his home. And it was unloaded by a professional moving company that were given the information from their dispatch that they needed to help someone move a refrigerator in the house. The dispatch was given pictures of the W8. They were given an email that I had written up about how fragile and heavy it was. All that information was given to this moving company, but they didn't give it to their boots on the ground guys that came to the site to load it. And I was terrified. I couldn't watch. These guys did everything wrong from a body mechanic standpoint and a safety standpoint, a manual handling. Things that will get you fired in my line of work. And thankfully, nobody got severely injured on site, although one guy was talking about his back after that. But yeah, y'all, you just can't imagine how much these weigh. As much cast iron and hardwood goes into them. Truly a fascinating piece of antique technology. That's nothing's been made like this in so long. Not just the technology of the refrigerating unit, but the cabinet construction, you know, made of hardwood and obviously hand assembled. All the square headed or, you know, square nut bolts that go in there. It's hard to find even hardware that's an exact match for it these days. Like I said in the previous video with the door hinges, I'm going to have to special order those pan head slotted type screws to hold the hinges on. Everything now is Phillips. Camera battery is getting low, so if it dies, I'll charge it up and then pick back up the video. For the you're not going to see any more changes in this because now that it's full enough that it's picking up a solid stream of liquid with no gas through the expansion device, additional refrigerant is just going to collect in the receiver, but it won't affect the pressures on the gauges. It won't affect the operation of the machine. I just want it in there so that as over time small losses occur, it's got some operating headroom. So the low side is down to 15 PSI. The high side's down to about 140. That will tell me that evaporator's getting cold in there. So I'm gonna cut the video and charge the battery and I'll be back. I turned off the shop fan so you could get a better idea how it sounds. We're down to about 8 PSI on the low pressure side and about 125 on the high. No frosting on the return line, that's a plus. This is just barely warm. So let's see how cold the evaporator is. Just over 10 degrees, but again, that thermometer is not really frozen to anything or touching anything. You can see where the frost line stops on the return line, back there about halfway. That's good. That means there's a tiny little bit of liquid coming back through that wick, but not enough to go back to the compressor. That'll carry the oil back when it's in operation. Look at that good frost on there. I like it. So far, that is a success. Other than this thing. That thing right there frustrates me, because after I put the silicone in there, you know, to make that look nice, now I got to cut all that silicone back out. But minor thing. You see the low side pressure went up because the door was open and that evaporated more of the stuff in the evaporator. The control was about to cycle off earlier, but now it went right back to the normal position because of the door being open. All right, folks. Well, I changed out those support struts, or the support hooks. That was the one that had the rope on it. And these new ones really work better from a standpoint of the shaking. And then I also put a little damper block in there of Bocell rubber foam. And changed the belt tensioner spring. I found one off an old unit back there in the junk bin. And everything is running so smooth now. So now I've got to face the music and take the side cover off and fix the cold control. And then from that point on, I'm still waiting for the relay for the light. They kind of stiffed me on that today. UPS says they might deliver it before 9 o'clock in the evening, which to me is kind of sorry. Just cycled off. I'm going to check and see what kind of frost we got in here before I turn it off. Well, it's door gasket's so good there wasn't actually frost. But you can see that's down below freezing. You can actually see the frost forming now that the door is open. You see this turning white? A lot of moisture in the air for it to take. All right, get on to my horrible job repairing that. Well, it's getting closer and closer to completion. Looking better by the minute as more parts go back on it. I went ahead and put the shelves and stuff in there temporarily. I still got to clean them up a little bit, but I just wanted to see how it's going to look with it all together. Turn off my camera light. You can get an idea of the cabinet lighting. You can see it turn off. So that part of it's working. One thing I've got yet to do, there's a screen that goes over the back of this. And that screen needs to be cleaned up and painted black. It's kind of rusted. So, and also I have the porcelain trim that goes around the screen. So that's going to be another day's project. I did get a hand screw deal here for opening this door. This one doesn't have a pull latch. This has got to be redone too. You see the new felt or cork board in there? I'm going to replace that as well. Carefully lower that down, and you'll probably notice that the cold control chain is hooked up, and the relay for the light is behind that cover. All that wiring is in place. The interconnect between the light and the condensing unit is there. So I'm going to turn the cold control up here and start it up. Nice and quiet. You can see why, if you had pets or children, small children, you definitely need a cover, because that would be very easy to reach the flywheel. And this one actually, as you can see, it has a screen on the bottom, which some of the others don't have. Well, it's been running maybe only 5 minutes, and if we look in here, this is already down to the almost below 40. So clearly it's working well. I'm gonna shut it down for the day. And pick back up on it tomorrow. It's looking good, I'm happy with it. Sounds good, so this one, we'll be put on a long-term test run for a while and make sure everything's stable, there's no leaks. And then from there, who knows? Catch you later.